Welcome to Project Studio Expo at AES. Today's the first day. We've got 3 days of amazing programming for you. And I hate to say we're starting with the best, but we're kind of starting off with the best. This is supposed to be an educational event where we teach you about professional tactics and tools and tips and that sort of thing. But we're going to go right to the top. And we're going to start with a fellow who's got more Grammys than just about anybody, who has worked with every artist under the sun. And the very first time I saw him, he was standing in front of the largest Focusrite console I have ever seen in the history of the world, with an air conditioner blasting down on top of it. He's known for all of this fantastic music. You've heard all of his work, but perhaps best known for his collection of hats. His haberdasher must be busy all the time. Without further ado, please welcome Jack Joseph Puig to talk about the art of compression.
So, the art of compression. You know, everybody has a certain way they like to do things, or things they really like to do, right? Some guys like to use a lot of positive equalization. You know, lots of people like to use subtraction equalization. People think it's all about reverb, or they think it's panning, or it's this, or it's that. Everyone has things that they feel is a tool that makes the most sense for them to do what we're supposed to do, which is basically take what the artist is creating and get it to come out of a piece of paper, speakers with magnets, and convey an emotion and a thought to you that could change your life or someone else's life, right? If we really think about what we do, right, we make spells, we make poems, and we make these poems and they go out in the world and we don't know where they're going to go. Could be Russia, could be Germany, could be Alaska, and it could save somebody from wanting to take their life. It can make a child. It can do all kinds of things. It's actually a really massive responsibility that we have. If you really look, you know, from a 1,000-foot view of what we're actually supposed to be doing. The one thing that I would like to make sure it doesn't get lost in all of this today, as I show you a few things and we have questions, etc., is that what no one leaves her away with is, gee, he talked about compression, he's very passionate, but he didn't talk about balance. As we all know, balance is singly the most important thing we do. We've all heard records that sound like shit. And we've all heard records that sound amazing. Sometimes they're balanced well, sometimes they're not. But when it's balanced great, it always works. It just always works. And balanced right doesn't mean that all the levels are perfect, right? I mean, I know as I've gone along in my career and I look back at some of the records that, you know, I thought were really great, that I admired, that I have a romantic view of, nothing else, like a Beatle record, let's say. And it's like, damn, that tambourine is like at least 10 dB louder than I would ever put it. Like, what the hell? But it works. Balance is key. And what is balance? You know, basic balance, as you can see here, is three components for the most part. We can argue other things, but effectively we're really talking about level, right? Now when I say level, a lot of people think of level as at 1K, you know, like the actual the main aspect of how your ear perceives level, right? But we all know that equalization is level. It's the same thing. It just makes one part of the band louder than another part of the band. I know some of you are very well educated, and so I'm basically telling you the sky's blue. But for those, please be patient with the ones that this might be their first time. So I'm trying to talk very general to hopefully have everyone leave with something. And then, of course, there's panning. It's level too, right? And that's certainly balance. So look at compression. Look what they say here. They say that compression is, look at that list. I mean, squeezing, crushing, heavy, stress, load, reduction. The action of compressing or being compressed. I don't see it that way. I don't see it as how loud it can be. I don't see it as crushing it into something. I don't understand that. Like, why would I want to take something that's supposed to be dynamic music and reduce it to, like, so it's brain dead effectively from dynamic? Like, I don't know why people see it that way, you know, but they do, right? You look at this other definition, it talks about reducing the dynamic range. Parallel compression is what everyone talks a lot about, right? If we look at what's happening now in the last, you know, 5 or 7 years with the ability that you all have, and we all have actually, to go online and see what a lot of people are talking about and doing, the rage has been parallel compression now. Right? Parallel compression. I do this. I have these 25 billion compressors. I ran them through the board. I put them all together. Parallel. Guess what? Parallel compression's been around since I can remember, from my teachers. This is nothing new. In some ways, parallel compression is cheating. Because what you're doing here, as you see on my slide, it says RMS level or average level. So what you're doing is you bring the lower level information up higher, right? And the idea is that you're not touching the peak information, which is kind of not really what happens. What ends up happening is you just make it really, really loud. So basically you took the compressor and just turned everything up, kind of. Again, kind of a shame. So if you look in this little screen here, you'll see the RMS, which is what I was just talking about, ratio, and you'll see the peak value. The object is to not take that RMS level and just make it as loud as you can, but the object is to look at compression as, gee, parallel compression is musical and can be. But compression overall can be extremely musical, right? Why? Because it has an attack and it has a release. So what that means is it's moving time. An equalizer is static, right? It just adds a frequency, takes away a frequency, but it doesn't have anything to do with the time domain, unless you have a real issue with phase, right? But I think that's really a whole nother kettle of worms. So what we're talking about is that compression is a very musical because it has an attack and it has a release, right? It's not static, but it's dynamic. When I made the plugins, when I created the plugins with Waves in 2005, I went to them with the idea of wanting to do my own plugin, and they told me I was out of my mind because that's what they do, and I was on an ego trip, and who the hell do you think you are, and that's what we do. Right? And I'm like, well, I see what's coming right now. It's not the same. The commercial record studios aren't quite as big as it used to be. I see less of them. I see the beginning of, you know, operators transpiring inside their own homes or in different spaces. And I also see the beginning of the musician in a different way, meaning the DJ, right? The DJ is none other than the same thing as you see with the DJs on the radio. DJ in the radio has always chose the songs he's going to play for you. Now the DJ also does the same thing at the gig. The only difference is he also makes records. But it's the same thing. He decides what he's going to play, whether he's going to play a Michael Jackson record or if he's going to play, you know, a Steely Dan record, whatever it is that he's going to play. So what I wanted to do with this is get people to start thinking sound design. The reason why I showed you this is because I want you to think like you're a sound designer. If nothing else, I want you to leave here hopefully thinking about this and making it your own and thinking about what you could do and how it might make you see other things that you didn't think about before. That's all I want to do. I want you to go away and think about the fact that there is an intelligent way to make some of the decisions that we do when we make art. When we can marry science and art perfectly together, that's when we hit it. It's actually the science and the art meeting, right? So here's your typical sine wave, right? You've seen that a million times. Let me show you visually what I'm talking about here. If you look at a sawtooth, which is the top one, right? When you have a very, very, very aggressive sawtooth wave like that, your ear can identify exactly where the sound is hitting in a musical bar, right? So, let's see, does it allow you to see the cursor? Okay, you're not, can't see the cursor. But if you could imagine looking at that. So you have that entire sine wave, right? And in between there, let's just call those right now eighth notes for the conversation. And you could identify, if it's peaky like that, you could identify exactly where those eighth notes sit within a bar. Are they early? Are they late? Are they fast? So, you know, when you go to the movie theater, you hear THX, you know, which is the big low frequency sound. And then when it goes to Sony Digital, what do you hear? That's how the ear knows where something is. If the semi goes behind us right now, we don't know if it's behind us or in front of us. We can't locate that low frequency, but we can locate, right, higher frequencies. So where that peak information is and those higher frequencies is how our brain determines where something is. Does that make sense? So if I do what the bottom one is, let's say I do a stupid amount of compression, right? Taking any one of those, like an L1 compressor, any kind of compressor you can think of, and just compress the shit out of it, right? You get what you see on the bottom. So look at that bottom. If you look at that bottom sine wave, what do you see? You see a square. How does your ear know where that begins and where it ends? And it only hears where it starts to square, and then it gets lost after that. Top one, you hear the attack, you know exactly where it is, comes back down, you hear the attack again. This is the art of compression, is shaping that sine wave. And I know this is a little geeky and a little techy, but if you just kind of look at it a little bit like this, I think if maybe you already do, it will really help you with the real art of compression. So shaping, not just how loud can I get it, but shaping it, right? So looking at it as, gee, as I adjust the attack and the release, I can, if I make a release that's, if I make a slow attack where it doesn't grab it, it waits, then it's going to make the little peak information you see here at a different location. Let me give you an example. So there's the target point, right? There's a sine wave with a peak in it. Depending where I adjust the attack or the release, is going to tell me, is going to put that that peak that you see in a different place. Does that make sense? So if we had not a fast attack, that little peak that you see in the sine wave, right, would come later. If we have a fast attack where it grabs it and makes a quick spike, it's going to move that spike closer to the front. Now my ear is going to see that as faster. Or if it's the other way, it's going to see it as slower, lazier, laying back in the bar line, as they say, right? Or on top of the beat, as you hear. This is the musical terms you hear in cyber recording studios. This is a technical understanding of why it does that, right? That's what you want to see. You want to see many, many, many points of position. Here again, you see what happens when you square it. Does everybody understand that so far? Before I go any farther, are there any questions? You have a question? Show a microphone, please.
Hi.
Who had the question?
This lady right here.
Hi. So, for the target point, I'm just like a little bit confused. I'm sorry. I'm still learning. Sorry, everyone. I just wanted to make sure what you're saying is essentially like, depending on where you use compression, it can go before the bead or behind the bead, and then it affects like how fast or slow you hear.
Well, think of a beat. Let's see. So let me give you a visual. So if you look at this here, the slide, right?
Mm-hmm.
The typical sine wave, not the one that has a little peak that's sticking up, but the actual body of the sine wave.
Right.
Think of that as anything, a voice, a bass drum, a snare drum, a tambourine, right? That little peak that you see is where the ear is going to detect where the tambourine sits as it relates to the other instruments. So each instrument has this, mm-hmm. and each instrument has its own peak, right?
Right.
And the object is to line those peaks up so that it feels like they're all playing together. Music is all playing together. Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, that totally makes
sense. So in Pro Tools, mm-hmm. right, you can actually move things around. But that's not the same thing. This is like an expert page. This is like going, okay, yeah, we could go in Pro Tools and we could move something around and say, okay, this snare is flaming. Oh, move it by 10 milliseconds or move it by a quarter note, whatever it might be, right? Yeah, you're lining it up.
Mm-hmm.
But this is the next level. It's not just lining it up, but it's actually controlling how hard it hits when they line up.
Okay. Now I see what you mean.
Does that make sense?
Yes, it does. Thank you.
So this is what you do. You move it around to get it to like, and sometimes you want it to be a little bit late. You want it to be a little early. Maybe you want the guitar strings, the attack of them, to feel like it's laying back, and you want the drums to be fast. Okay. So it feels exciting, but still kind of sexy.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, it totally does. Thank you so much.
So you're trying to just move that around with the compression. Now, how loud I can make it, how can I shape, right, that sine wave to manipulate it in such a way where I am playing it like an instrument?
Yeah, so it's giving it dynamic.
Yes. Dynamic in time. Not just in peak, but how fast and slow it is.
Okay.
Because you have a time release, right? A time constant.
Thank you.
No problem. Another question, I think?
Question? There'll be more time for Q&A at the end as well.
Okay, I'll just show a little something here. Let's see. Should we be hearing this in headphones? Should we be hearing that? I don't have the music in the headphones.
I'd like to think the best of me.
can't sort of determine how fast or slow the guitar is in terms of how it relates to the drums and the bass. As I start to move this attack, if I get real aggressive with it. There kind of, I don't know where it is. I don't know if it's that fast, slow, if it's just kind of playing. But here, I can start to determine. I can listen, zone in on it and the hi-hat. And hear like, oh, are they playing together? Is one ahead of the other one? Are they grooving together? Are they slow? Are they fast? And I picked this because this makes just a radical example of what I'm talking about, right? So, when you get the art of compression right, and you find the spot, see right there, it's now fitting with the drums. Doesn't feel early, doesn't feel late, feel like it's grooving well. If I turn on the vocal here, this one.
Their memories, tiny tragedies.
So now my ear is listening to the guitar and the drums. Now it goes, okay, I wanna hear the nuances of his voice, the breaths, the little icks, the ticks, the little lip smacks, all those little things. But I wanna move them to where they lock with everything else. Sorry, it's not behaving right now. When I go in and out, how the voice and the guitar connect. Can you hear how they lock, how they move into the same place, and they play like an orchestra, right? That's a little bit of an exaggerated example of what I'm talking about. But every compressor will do that. No matter what kind of compressor you use, all of them have an attitude and the way they move and how much they change time. And the object is to think about aligning the sound essentially with compression. Why you want to do it with the compression as opposed to going in Pro Tools, right, and taking the sine wave and moving them all around, is the compression is breathing, it's moving. The other way, all you're doing is just lining everything up. Yeah, it's all hitting, boom, 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 boom. It's like, why is it just like boring? Why is it just going along? It's just, I don't care. This way it's moving in and out, right? It's moving in time. And that's what you want. If you think about, I don't know if any of you are live musicians, but you know, when you play the gig and you're on the stage, there's just that sound where it feels like everything is moving. You know, it's almost like you're on, been drinking too much, you're screwed up on drugs. You know, it's like so fucking cool. Like, wow, it's just like you're on some kind of a drug trip, right? And that's what compression should do. It should be like, whoa, we're just like riding the horse. It's like moving beautifully, sloping, it's sexy, right? It's not a matter of just making it loud and making it all together, tech, 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 boring. That's the object. That's the art of compression, is if you can get your head into looking at it that way. And maybe some of this makes sense to you now, maybe some of it doesn't, but I guarantee if you go away and let it seek in, and the next time you get behind and you start playing with something, you'll be like, I see what he was talking about. I see what he means, and I see now how I can make something that was kind of like a drum machine, kind of stiff and robotic. It just didn't feel great. And now I can see how I can breathe life into it and make it move. Does that make sense? If nothing else, I want you guys to leave thinking about it. And then thinking about everything, like, oh, so what does that mean about reverbs and about the pre-delay of a reverb? What does it do to that? See, the thing that we have right now is we're all growing up in what I call the preset generation. In other words, no one's really kind of asking the question, why? You're just doing it. But why? How did it get there? Why is it like that? Once you understand what the why is, then you can screw with it. Because you know what it's supposed to be. You know where ground zero is. Does that make sense? And meanwhile, you guys are like, and like me, all of us, you know, there's a plethora of stuff we can see online, right? From a lot of people. When I started, there was none of that. So I had a romantic notion of like what they were doing. Their compressor probably was purple, and you know, they had 9 of them, and the board was like 200 inputs, and there were people, you know, giving them back rubs. And you know, this whole like idea of what it was, only to find out that, oh, so it was a U47 with a 1073 and an LA2. Oh yeah, yeah. Wow. What else did you do? No, that was it. That's how so-and-so recorded Elton John or recorded whoever, right? That wasn't the magic. You all here are the magic. It's up to you and your creativity to win. And to be successful is tenacity, to never, 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 never give up. No matter how many times someone tells you your shit ain't great, you know what? You ain't great. You keep trying. And all this is illustration today is to make you look at this in a way like, oh, I never thought of it that way. I never thought about the attack and release. I never thought of it. I just thought that when I saw the thing on YouTube, or I went to Mix the Masters, or I went to the Waves booth, I just thought you put 1176 and you push all the buttons in. Cool. That's what they do, so that's what I do. No. Think about what you're doing. Go away and think of it artistically. Like, what can I do? Why am I doing this? What's a different way to do something? That's when you make great, great stuff. Does that make sense? Are there any questions? This gentleman has a question.
Can you hear me? Yes. Love your plugins. I use them quite a bit. I'm wondering, in your sort of regular production workflow, do you often use multiple compressors because of their different sort of paintbrush characteristics to sculpt the sound you're going for? And when you're doing a session, are you using these tools like across the board, or do you tend to be very selective about where you apply them? in practice?
I own 97 compressors, at last count, and I absolutely think very much about where I put them, because they all have a different character to them. And the reason why I have a lot of them is sometimes we need stuff to feed us, you know. So the analogy I always use is, you know, you might be in your phase, if you're a guitar player, you might be in a phase of using Gibson, right? And then something happens, someone knocks the guitar down, the neck breaks, and you're like, well, we need another guitar. And you pick up a Stratocaster. And you're like, oh, I forgot about how cool these guitars are. And then it inspires you. So you need different tools that you can grab sometimes, maybe one you don't use for 6 months, and then you rediscover it, right? And it's that constant thing of rediscovering that keeps you trying different things. In terms of in the workflow, I'm always, you guys have heard this a million times, I'm always trying to make it sound like that's the record, the best I can every second, so that I don't put more of something that I don't need. You know, if you stop and think about how many times we hear something before we're done with it, it's got to be in the hundreds, right? And the listener only heard it the one time. They haven't heard it 100 times. So we're bored with it. Okay, well, now put strings on it. Oh, now do this, though, more background vocals. Oh, I don't know, three more loops. Oh, put this, 10 more hand claps, do this, do that, this reverb, because we're bored with it. But someone else has never heard it before, so it's easy to pass it up. That's a little bit of an extension of your question, but it's a point I thought that's important. Anything else?
I just have a couple questions. I was wondering, do you vary that relationship between instruments throughout the song, the level of compression, or do you like to sort of keep it constant?
Depends on time, how much time you have. I have a thing called multi-stereo, which I'm going to show tomorrow at Mix at the Masters. And it's essentially kind of, it's basically moving for different sections of the song, right?
Yeah.
A different treatment. When we were making records with tape machines, right, I caught the tail end of that, of tape machines, the very, very tail end of it. You didn't have that ability because we're all kind of moving live. Now with Pro Tools, or any, actually DAW, I should say, right, you have the ability to stop and create whatever you want to create. So it just depends on how much time you have and how much you want to go down to, like, sort of, we'll call it the expert page. Right?
Okay.
The details. Oh, the song starts off with a piano and a voice. It's probably not the same compression setting as when the entire orchestra comes in the bridge.
Yeah. Okay.
Right?
Thank you. That makes sense. My other thing that I was going to ask was, are you ever concerned with maintaining your artistic fingerprint if your artists or a genre requires something that, or asks for something that you don't normally do, or you don't really want to implement? Does anybody ask you, I want more compression or less compression?
Gwen Stefani, I think is a good example, said to me, I want my voice to sound like it's like angels. Like there's all this like airy angel on my voice, right? And a large part of what we do is we interpolate, like, what the hell does that mean? Like an angel, right? And of course your mind immediately goes to some kind of brightness or something, right? And at the time I had one of my Joe Meek equalizers that had a certain knob on it, kind of like an Aphex type sound, and I exaggerated as far as I could and I paralleled that in, and she was like, that's it. That then became something I use all the time and take full credit.
Mm-hmm.
So it's excellent to do that. What people remember is, yes, you got my song to come out of the speakers. No, you didn't. And the biggest, I probably only have 6 or 7 in the entire time I've done this, memories where someone cried or they looked at me and they said, how did you know that was inside my head? How did you know? How did you get it to do that? It was only inside my head. That's the ultimate dream. That is what you want. Not how cool something sounds, but like, that's exactly what I saw in my head and it's now coming out the speakers. So it's whatever it takes to get there.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Jack, I've got a couple of questions for you.
Sure.
You started in the analog world working with compression and EQ and all of that stuff. How do you find that translates into the plug-in world? Do you find that you have more flexibility with a plug-in or are using the same techniques?
It actually, a lot of the rules still apply, right? So, give you an example. if the plugin's in the first slot, it sounds better than if it's in the fifth slot. So how do I relate that to analog? Well, same thing. We used to say gold wire versus a silver wire, or a canny connector versus an Amphenol connector, or thicker patch bay connection is better than not a patch bay connection. It's kind of the same thing. So what I'm trying to do, even with this, this very, very simple, and this, you know, what I'm doing, showing you here, if we had like 8 hours and we could actually hear, and I went through sessions and I showed you stuff, you'd be like, your brain would explode, because I promise you would never think of compression the same way. So I'm giving you a very, very, very extremely elementary basic understanding with the hope of you going, I'm throwing everything out and I'm thinking about everything. I'm taking nothing for granted, including where I put the plug-in. I know if I put it in the first slot, I have a higher resolution than if it's in the last slot. I know that if I turn down the volume on certain plugins, that doesn't sound as good as when it's at zero, right? But I could use that to my advantage. If I wanted something that was a little too bright and I tried fixing it with EQ or compression or a de-esser and I just can't seem to, you know, I want a lower resolution and the lo-fi plugin doesn't do it, and on and on, you could put a Focusrite compressor on it, an equalizer on it, turn down the volume of it and be like, whoa, it's warmer because the resolution is not as good. So it's, again, the same analog thinking, really, just applied to digital domain. Does that make sense?
Absolutely. What about ordering your plugins? EQ first, compression first? Is it a case-by-case basis, that sort of thing?
The main rule about that is when you have equalization before the compression, right, you now are making the compressor act a different way, right? So if the compressor has a low end, it's going to act one way coming into it in terms of how it grabs the information, that even what we're talking about here. And if it has a lot of top end, it's going to react differently. At that point, then you are playing the compressor, right? You're making the compressor react a certain way. The equalization after the compressor, right, won't do that, but will pick up maybe desirable or non-desirable artifacts that are in the compressor. So if it's a compressor, it kind of has a lot of thickness to it, you're going to get the bottom of the equalizer is going to act better after than it's going to do before.
Interesting.
They're really simple things, but they're actually kind of how it is.
Well, so I'm sorry to take all your time, you guys, but this is fascinating. I never get an opportunity to do this. Could you walk us through the signal path on John's vocal on that track? What did you use to get that sound, or was that just coming out of his face?
I was just using this to control. I mean, it's really nothing. You know, again, what I've been trying to get everybody to understand here is that I promise you, you know, I see what some of the people say, and I think to myself it's disappointing sometimes what some of the answers are. They're not as deep as I want them to be. And the only way you can really get those kinds of deep answers is to either focus on one particular thing or have the time to do it, right? So all I'm doing here, I put this in only because I know it. I know what it is. And again, it's getting people to think like a sound designer, right? Because you're not thinking in terms of frequencies. You're thinking of attitude and attack and space, right? So effectively, what the vocal sound here, really large part of it, actually is this device here, which is really, really, really good about bringing up all the nuances. You know how when you stand next to an instrument when you're recording it, or a voice, and you're like, then you go inside the control room, you're like, that's weird. Like, the speaker was kind of like vibrating, but I don't feel it vibrating inside the control room. And when I was listening to the person sing, I could hear all the cry in their voice, but I don't hear it in here. It sounds good, but I don't feel it, right? And a lot of that's because that low-level stuff, you know, the little crack in the voice and all those kinds of things get lost, right? And all the instruments that are compressed to hell and back, and it's trying to compete with that. And what you need to do with this is a very good thing, is this low level here really brings up the character. And you guys saw that, right, when I was moving it up and down. I don't think I need to illustrate that. But that can also get you in trouble, because when you're lifting it up and down, you'd be paying attention, right, to where all his breaths and his P's and his T's are sitting against the track. Because if you don't, you can be like, well, I really hear everything's really clear, but like, I don't know, I kind of liked it better before. Well, it's because you don't have it aligned. So it's just not grooving. Your foot's not moving. Does that make sense? If it doesn't make sense, I want someone to say, I don't understand that. Because I hate it when people leave and they're like, I didn't get anything. Then this was a waste of time. Everyone loses. That's not good.
How about noise floor using the MV2? Do you find that brings up the noise floor a lot when you crank it that much?
It can.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Do you do anything to fix that, or is it just part of the track?
Filtering would be the next approach if that happened, or a gate, depending on what it is, right?
I want you guys to have a look at this Pro Tool session and look how few plugins there are in this whole session. I mean, you're just talking about simplicity, about working something until it sounds right.
So on one of the Mix of the Masters I did, one of the things that was great is people bring stuff and you listen to their stuff and you give them your input, you know, what you think. It's just your input. Doesn't mean you're right or wrong. It's just what you think, right? And one guy brought in this beautiful, it was a big orchestra piece, and he was an orchestrator. He was not an engineer, wasn't a producer. He was an orchestrator. And it was like 95 tracks of this massive orchestra. Hit play, and it was just like mud. It was just like, what the fuck is this shit? I mean, it was horrific, right? But I could tell that it was intelligent the way it was put together, but it sounded really bad. So I look at the session, and every channel must have at least a minimum of 3, if not 5 plugins, right? And so I just grabbed option, clicked across, right? Delete, you know, put everything in bypass, did a quick balance, and he was like, oh my God, what did you do? It sounds amazing. Well, you're an orchestrator. When you wrote down this orchestra and you thought about where the violins go, and where the cellos go, and where the piano is, you voiced the chord. Yeah, that's exactly what I do. I voice the chord. I figure out whether, you know, the third should be on the top or the fifth should be on the bottom. And, you know, I voice the chord so it sounds like THX. Bling, everything sits. And it's beautiful sounding. Well, then why would you put a bunch of shit all over the top of it and change the voicing? Because what do you mean? I go, EQ is voicing. There's no difference. There is absolutely no difference between voicing the instruments or EQing is exactly, literally the same thing. He goes, oh, but I saw in the video that's what, you know, the guys with 3 names do, and this guy does, and that guy's, and they put the 11-6, and they smack the shit out of it, smack that shit. And they do, and I did all that stuff. Yeah, but why? You didn't need to. You already put it when you did the orchestra. Oh, so you don't have to put all that stuff on there? No. In fact, you'd be surprised how much of it you can make work if it's just balanced right. Amazing. There's some guys that I listen to their records, I'm like, they have no concept of tone. There's just no tone. Nothing really sounds great tone wise but it's balanced. I can hear the voice, the chorus comes in like it's supposed to, the bridge blows up, the outside outro gets bigger, it all works. That's the bottom line at the end, right? It's communicating an emotion and a feeling, however it has to do it. But then you have, you know, the expert things. You have those special records that you listen to and you're like, okay, it's got everything, right? Sounds amazing, it's balanced great, the song's awesome. And the truth is, most likely the song was awesome in the very beginning. So when you get a record that's really, really, really great, when they hand you it to mix, kind of hard to screw it up. And the idea there's only one guy that could mix some hip song, it's bullshit. Lie. It's probably 50 guys, 100 guys that could do it when it's really, 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 really great. So when you guys see the ego and the bravado of these people, just dismiss it. First of all, God gave them the talent at birth. It's not even theirs to take. They didn't make the talent. It was given to them at birth. All you guys, I keep saying this to people, you've got to just believe in what you do and believe in yourself, right? Because Oz didn't give the Tin Man anything he didn't already have. Already had it. I want you to think like that. I want you to go away and think like that. I want you to think about what I'm saying. I want you to think about approaching things differently. Not just taking everything you see online and going, oh, that's how it is because they had the latest hit record with blah, blah, blah. In fact, a lot of the records that the artists are bringing in now because of Pro Tools, kind of already there. They already have their reverbs. They already have their delays. They already have a balance. You're basically putting on a little bit of makeup lots of times. You're not reinventing the wheel. Where in the past, you didn't have things like that. Things were acoustical instruments, and you had to actually create the vibe and put something together. Now it kind of comes to you. And actually, the biggest job is not to not F it up. You know? Not to put your own stamp on it and think it's all about you and not about you. Very, very important. I know this, it has nothing to do with 1176 versus an LE2, but I promise this kind of thinking will take you much farther in your career than trying to figure out if it's 1176 or an LE2 to put on the bass. I promise. I'm not making that up. If something else? Any questions?
Questions anyway, yeah.
This may be a bit of a naive question, but I'm going to ask it anyway. What's your process of assessing the character, the flavor of a new compressor or, you know, a new reverb, you know, when it comes into your life?
Everything I get new, I live with it for a minute. One of the things that happens with us is that we jump on stuff as an industry. And sometimes it works out and sometimes it doesn't, right? You need time with something to understand how it works and where to apply it. And sometimes you may try it and not like it. It's kind of like a song you hear on the radio. You're like, I don't like that song. Then a week later, after the fifth time, you're like, kind of like it, right? And then the tenth time, you're like, I really like that song. But the first time, you didn't like it. Gear is exactly the same way. You try it, you play with it, and you find a spot where it really works. And there are things that just work, right? An SM57 will work. Kind of just will work. Almost anything, right? There are some of those go-tos for sure.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Oops, thanks. Questions? See one in the corner?
I have a question, and I'm not exactly sure. I think this was a vocal seminar, and we're talking about compression, but I think maybe we could tie it together. But I'm wondering really what kinds of ways we can create more space and depth in recordings. Like at this point, I'm learning how reverb in plugins can have settings for creating sort of space and depth, and
let me answer that. First of all, the whatever that's called is incorrect. What it says is incorrect. It should have said the art of compression, and it doesn't. It says a vocal. So that's that. This was not a vocal session. It was a mistake. In terms of that, that's a whole nother discussion. A large way to get that kind of stuff is with harmonics. That's how I do it. So always remember that everything is relative, right? Something's on the left because something's on the right. Up, down, close, you know, male, female, sour, sweet, black, white, right? That's how our brains work. I know you're there because my brain is mapping this entire room, including this podium, and it's measuring between here and here and then where you are. And that gives me an idea about how far you are, right? So everything is like that. It's the way our brains work. So in most modern records, and that's part of the reason why I do this art of compression thing. In most modern records, right, everything is just as compressed as it can be. So now we're really on one domain. So how does my brain know, if everything's in the same plane, how does it know that something's over there or behind that or even behind that? If you listen to some of the older records, you know, like, I don't know why I picked this, but like an Elton John record or something, right, you can hear the multiple levels of actually dimension, Z, how far it goes in, which is what you're talking about, right? That's because something's loud and because something is soft. If everything is loud, then there's no relationship between the loud thing and the soft thing, right? And that's where the peak information comes. If you use a tremendous amount of parallel compression, you're gonna hear all week here, all they're gonna talk about is parallel compression. I use these 5 compressors, I do this, I mix all these compressors together. Okay, that's all great. Basically, you're just making it all kind of loud. But you're not actually creating a dynamic between instruments. Do you see what I'm saying? with this peak stuff I'm talking about, you're actually, they're sticking out while another one's not sticking out. So the ear's going, oh, I hear that. Oh, I hear that. And it sees what I call positional audio. Like in gaming. Gaming is all about positional audio. This is where 3D audio is. This is where we're all going, right? Right now. Right? I work a lot in the consumer side. So I'm working with Apple. I'm working with Facebook, Google, and Amazon, right? That's another part of what I do. And part of that goes into the gaming, which is positional audio, which is very, very important to win the game. You got to know where something, where the gunshot's coming. And part of the way you know where that is creating these kinds of clear peak points where the ear can identify, like the Dolby analogy I gave, as opposed to the THX one, which also gives you the dimension where something is. So it's creating positional audio.
Thank you very much.
Does that make sense? Like, just think about it like that. It'll hit you in a few days. If it doesn't now, you'll be like, okay, I get it. I promise.
We got time for one more question for Jack. Anyone have a question? Oh, way in the back. Meet me halfway.
I took you literally on that one. Good morning. Question about peak versus RMS. Do you have any general applications? I'm thinking like peak maybe for percussion, RMS for strings, and this is how I'm trying to interpret it. And maybe on the mix bus, maybe RMS. How do you choose between those two?
Basically, look at it this way. Everything has RMS and everything has peak. So as a designer, not as an engineer, not as a mixer, as a sound designer, right? You're deciding how much of the peak versus how much of the RMS and where that peak sits, like I was showing you. Where does it sit, like in the picture, you know, you see here? Where does that attack sit as it relates to the sine wave? You know, is it early? Is it late? Is it start right away or is it wait a minute? So it's both. It's not either or. RMS average is important, right? Because it's what makes something sound loud, right? But the peak is the positional audio part of it. Where something is positioned as it relates to other instruments. That's the art of compression.
Thank you.
Great question, great answer. What a great way to wrap up this master class. And who knew we were going to get philosophy as well as compression techniques? This is pretty cool. So, ladies and gentlemen, the original three-name guy, Jack Joseph Puig.